Beloved in Christ, grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ.
And also to you.
You know, our text today takes place during Christ's Sermon on the Mount. If you've been reading the gospel lesson, we've been going through that over the last couple weeks. It takes place directly after Jesus has described the blessed connection of his disciples in their building up of his kingdom and their great responsibility of letting their light shine out into the world in good works because of their adoration and love for God. In Christ's presentation of his great sermon, he now shifts the discussion to speak about the law. And he makes clear that everything being taught is in complete agreement with the entire Old Testament, but it is also in glaring conflict with the righteousness and the rabbinical perversions that had been built up and practiced by the Pharisees and the scribes. You see, since the Pharisees and scribes professed to be experts and promoters of the Old Testament, it was necessary for Jesus, the one who so completely contradicted them in principle and in detail, Christ needed to make certain that his disciples and followers knew that he had no intention to abolish or modify the Old Testament scriptures in any way. Christ was simply to make sure his followers knew that the righteousness that was put forth by the legalistic Pharisees would never lead to the kingdom of God. And Jesus wanted to ensure that his disciples knew the righteousness he established would fulfill the entire Old Testament in both reality and detail. Today we will look at a subject that every one of us should be able to relate to in one way or another: the law. And we all know what laws are. They are rules of behavior telling us what we are supposed to do and what we are not supposed to do. And while we might not like some of the regulations each of us are subject to, I don't think we could even ever imagine the devastation that would happen to each one of us if life had no laws. And I believe it would be an accurate statement to say that without having laws in society, we couldn't live life, at least not very effectively. They are that important. So with that in mind, it shouldn't be too hard to understand and agree that the law of God is important too. You see, God's laws are his way of telling us he knows what is best for our protection and our well-being. However, it's very significant to recognize, as the disciples of Christ recognized, that the law of God has been grossly misinterpreted. Emphases have been given it which were never intended to be given in the first place. Its real function has been distorted. Its real purpose has been clouded. Its main duty of the law has been sidelined. Today we are going to look at God's law to see its intended purposes for us. But in order for us to see its true meaning, we cannot look at the law abstractly by itself, but we must see it in relation to how it applies to Christ. So as we examine our text today, we will not only see the law, but we will also see Christ and ourselves. Today's reading is from the book of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 17 through verse 19. I would ask if you're able to again rise out of respect for God's glorious truth. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law and the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not a iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. These are your holy words, Heavenly Father. Sanctify us in its truth. Your word is the only living truth. Please be seated. In all the world, no person was ever more misunderstood and misrepresented than Jesus Christ. The Jews hated him because he refused to accept their dead legalism, and the Pharisees and the scribes sought to get rid of him because he boldly attacked their false sense of righteousness. In other words, Jesus collided with the religious leaders of his day. He attacked their pet sins. They didn't like it. He gave them the truth, and it hurt. Whenever Jesus came in contact with these self-righteous hypocrites, there was conflict because he attacked their most precious possession, the law. But just what is the law? Well, the first thing we need to know is that the law can never be properly understood apart from Jesus Christ. In fact, all of the Old Testament regulations were directly related to him. All of the ceremonial laws of the Old Testament, the laws of worship, the laws of sacrifice, all these things were all related to the coming of Christ. All of these sacrifices and ceremony were done simply to remind the people of Christ's coming sacrifice. You see, the sacrifices which the priests offered up to God for the sins of the people were necessary until the Christ to be offered up came. And when Christ came to be offered on the cross of Calvary as the one complete and permanent sacrifice for all who will believe and trust on him, it was all fulfilled. So all of these Old Testament ceremonial laws then pointed to the coming of Jesus Christ. But they could not be set aside or abolished until Christ came. And when Christ did come, they were not destroyed as many people thought, but they were now fulfilled and no longer necessary as they had been in the past. And that's what Jesus meant when he said this. Matthew 5:17 reads, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." In other words, all the laws of worship and sacrifice in the Old Testament had now served their purpose. Their use was at an end. And that is why today the church has no temple worship or sacrifice requirements. That is why today we do not have to follow these rigid rules that were outlined in the Old Testament for worshiping God. Because all these things were a part of the ceremonial law which no longer exists. Christ fulfilled them all. However, when Jesus said he came not to abolish the law or the prophets, with that statement he was confirming the full authority of the Old Testament as scripture for all time, even down to the smallest components of the written text. But while the elements regarding the blood sacrifices and other ceremonial laws were accomplished and fulfilled in Christ's coming, there is another law which Christ has also fulfilled, but which has not been set aside. This is the law of the Ten Commandments. This is the law of right conduct, the relationship which we should strive to maintain as disciples of God between our neighbor and ourselves. And while it is unjustified to regard the law in our text today as referring only to the legal requirements of the Old Testament, because the law here is referring to every single part of that written word, including prophecy and as well as command, the doctrines of the Ten Commandments from the Old Testament are still in effect today. And they are as essential, according to Christ, as long as heaven and earth exists. Matthew 5:18 reads, "For truly I say to you, unless heaven and earth pass away, not a iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished." Now this means that not one single particle of the written word will pass away without receiving its fulfillment. Every single part of that word will stand until all has been accomplished and fulfilled. And while some of God's words have already been accomplished and have reached their completed purpose in Christ, other words of God are still in the process of fulfillment. But by Christ's coming, the ceremonial law has now been set aside. It's been fulfilled and accomplished in Jesus. But the law of the Ten Commandments, the moral law, is still in effect today, and it is our duty, as described by God, to keep these commandments at the forefront of our lives. Yet it is right here, it is right at this point, that the law of God has been grossly misinterpreted. You see, for so many people, Christ's connection to this law somehow seems easily forgotten. And when this occurs, Christianity can become either a law religion, a religion based on legalism or pietism and good behavior, a religion where people rely on their own perceived goodness and good deeds for eternal life, or Christianity can become a law-breaking religion, believing that because of God's grace, mercy, and forgiveness, well, what the heck? I'm forgiven anyway, so I can live any way I like, and because Jesus loves me, I mean, he's going to save me no matter what, right? But in either example, Christianity becomes a false religion because Christ and his atoning death is not properly understood as far as God's salvation plan is concerned. You know, one of the most common misunderstandings of God's law is if I live according to it, if I do the best that I possibly can, I will go to heaven. But that is wrong. The Ten Commandments were never given to us to get us to heaven. The law of God was given to us to show us that we can't get to heaven by keeping the law, because no one can ever keep it perfectly as God demands. You see, my friends, the law's main purpose is to make you feel guilty and bad about yourself because you can't keep the rules and do what God expects you to do. So much for that self-esteem. And here's the deal. Because if you don't feel bad about yourself, and if you don't see just how deceitfully wicked you really are, you will never see the need for Jesus. So the purpose of the Ten Commandments is to show us that we need someone to keep the law for us the way God demands we keep it. That someone is Christ. He alone can lift the weight of the law off of us. Loved ones, the law of God is binding upon each and every one of us. It tells us how to live our lives and demands of us certain moral obligations. But because we can never keep these laws as God demands, it is the law that drives us to our Savior, Jesus Christ. Galatians 3:24 reads, "So then the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith." And Romans 3:20 reads, "For by works of the law no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin." This tells us that the law was never intended to save us. Its purpose, from Mount Sinai to the coming of Christ, is to show us that we can't keep it. It is simply a means for driving us to Jesus. You know, if we could keep the law to perfection, none of us would need a Savior. We would get to heaven on our own ability because we could perfectly do as God commands. The problem is, of course, no one can do that because no one is perfect. The law then, instead of aiding in our eternal salvation, condemns us for being incapable of keeping it. Which means if we are to be saved, it must be through someone who could keep the law perfectly. That someone is Christ. You see, Jesus came to fulfill all of God's perfect requirements for us. He lived a perfect life. He had perfect obedience to his Father's will. He was perfectly submissive in all things. And because of God's loving grace, through my faith in Jesus, Christ's perfect life and obedience in keeping the law now belongs to me. And salvation is mine. It's mine when I place my trust in Jesus for my redemption. And loved ones, unless we receive this Christ who kept the law and who saves from sin into our hearts, we will never inherit eternal life. So with that being said, so then what becomes of the law of God? Are we simply to forget the law since we can never keep it? Are we to cast it aside since salvation is not found in it? No. Because we still must remember that God's law is binding upon each and every one of us. No part of the unfulfilled law will pass away as long as heavens and the earth exists. But our text today goes even further, showing us the necessity of the law by describing our place of position in the kingdom of God. Matthew 5:19 reads, "Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven." This means that while the law will never save us, it does in some unknown as of yet this side of heaven way determine our ranking in the kingdom of God. But it's also important to understand that the term commandments that are used here is more than just the Mosaic law, the Ten Commandments, or the legality in the commandments in the Old Testament. It's much more than that. It includes all that God asks of you and I as Christian disciples. In other words, the law is to be observed by us both in endeavoring to obey its commands, you know, as a guide to the way we should live our lives that's God-pleasing, but also in the proclamation, the proclaiming of it to others by teaching correct, sound doctrine and training them up in the Christian faith. And my friends, this is what is so wonderful about our God. You see, through God's Word and Spirit, He enables us to meet these discipleship requirements, not of our own abilities, but because of Christ and His power and His grace that is given to all who believe and trust in Him. And just as Jesus came to fulfill the entire Old Testament scripture, so all true followers of Christ are to cling to its entire contents, setting aside not even the least part. But my friends, if we are lax in our doctrine, if we are lax in our practice of God's holy law, If we are lax in our willingness to obey Christ and to let him rule in our hearts and use our lives and our talents for his purpose, leading others to him, we will be least in the kingdom of heaven over the one who does and teaches all of the commandments of God, who is called great in the kingdom of heaven. The scribes and the Pharisees in Christ's day read and studied the law of the prophets, seeking to achieve righteousness by keeping the law. They did not believe that Jesus came to fulfill the law and accomplish God's salvation plan. The question today is, do you? The question is, do you look for salvation in your own perceived righteousness by being a good religious person and keeping the law the best you can? Or do you now know that only in Christ and his gospel message that perfect righteousness can ever be obtained? Loved ones, our own righteousness is defective when judged by the true purpose and intent of God's law to show us that we are hopelessly lost sinners in need of help. Jesus demands a commitment to both the least and the greatest commandments, yet condemns those who confuse the two. Our text today tells us that God regards all who do his will and teaches his word in truth great, but considers those who neglect his word and his will least. Where do you stand with God right now? Loved ones, Christ's words today have enlightened us with extremely important truths concerning our relation with both Christ and the law. It is through the law that we see our own inadequacy, and it is this truth that drives us to Jesus Christ for his imputed righteousness that saves us. May all of us be found faithful to the will of our God, having received Christ as our only Savior, and being determined disciples eager to share God's word with others in truth, and be called great in his glorious heavenly kingdom. Glorious Heavenly Father, thank you for your words today, Lord. Let us all distinguish the difference between law and gospel. Let us know that the difference between law and gospel only pertains in what Christ did for us on the cross of Calvary. Then let us take that truth out into the world in this divided country and share it. In Jesus' name, amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.